It is my encouragement to you who are listening on the podcast or watching via YouTube to give our dear friend Mark Clifton a break. Give him a pass today. He got in at, what, 4 o'clock, did you say?
I walked through my front door at 4 o'clock this morning, and it's now, what, 5 o'clock when we're doing this, something like that?
Not quite, Mark. But not quite. If you'll just stay confused, we will keep everything going in order. Mark was in Alaska, specifically Anchorage, Alaska, and sounds like you had a red eye to get home with.
I did. I had a red eye, and the red eye was 3 hours late. So it was a late flight. But hey, it was a comfortable flight. I got home. I preached Sunday morning in Anchorage and was able to walk through my door at 4 a.m. Monday morning. So there you go. It's a long way to Anchorage. It's like, I don't know, 8,000 miles from here or something like that. It's crazy.
I understand. And look, if you want to sleep during a portion of this podcast, the listeners may not know the difference. So
that's true. It's happened in the past.
We'll give it a shot. By the way, in case you didn't know, you are listening or viewing Revitalize and Replant, sponsored by Revitalize and Replant. You're listening to, no, the sponsor is Revitalize and Replant, and you are listening to Revitalize and Replant by Mark Clifton, Kevin Ezell, and Thom Rayner, sponsored by the North American Mission Board. Go to churchreplanters.com or go to nam.net. And look at all the resources at churchreplanters.com. I'll say it again and again. We're so grateful to the North American Mission Board for the sponsorship. We're grateful that they're offering this as a ministry to you in the area of church revitalization and church replanting. Mark, today, this information will air beginning in December. And so today's will be December 2nd, and then we'll have a follow-up on December 9th and then December 16th. For 3 consecutive weeks, we're going to talk about why failure in ministry is not final. And I just got to commend you, because I see it on social media a good bit, and I hear directly on several occasions that you are really an encourager to people who are ready to toss in the towel. You're the guy that lets them know that, hey, this disillusionment that you're seeing, this downcast spell that you're going through is normal, and it may not feel good, or it may not feel right, but it's normal. And I've seen so many people come back to you and say, from a human point of view, you were salvific. So thank you for being who you are, Mark.
No, I appreciate that. Thank you very much. Comes from a lifetime of failure experience. So that's when you fail a lot, you learn a lot. So
I understand that fully, and I embrace it greatly. So yes, great, I get it. Great. For the listeners and the viewers, we have a fascinating 3-part series. The 3-part series again is "While Failure in Ministry Is Not Final," and today we'll be talking about when you get fired or pushed out of church. Our second part was when you fail in a church. And the third part is how to recover from failure in a church. So one, you're getting pushed out. The other, you sense your own failure. And the third part, how to recover from this. So if you feel like this information on the front end is tough, stay with us through episode 3 of this 3-part series, and we'll be sharing with you really some good news in the midst of all of this bad news. Just out of curiosity, Mark, before we get to the content, how many times a week do you have some level of contact with a disillusioned or down pastor or staff member? Every week? So
three or four times a week, easily. And it's a number of guys who are feeling like they're being forced out, pushed out. And, you know, you hear these stories, you think, are they really true? They're really true. I mean, they I can tell really you true. Stories where a guy goes on vacation. He hasn't taken a vacation in a year or two. He goes on vacation for a week, and while he's gone, the deacons have a meeting. I mean, it happens more often than you would ever know. And he comes back and he's just crushed. I remember Brian Croft, won't mind me telling you this. Brian Croft was there at the church in Louisville for a number of years and trying to revitalize that church, and finally took some time off and went up to visit some family, I think way up in the Dakotas or someplace. And fortunately, he had an assistant minister, associate pastor there who was covered his back. And while he was gone, the deacons were having a meeting to basically fire him. And so he said he called Brian, and Brian said, the only place I could get cell phone coverage is out in the middle of a cornfield. So I'm out there trying to get cell phone coverage and hearing this broken message that they're getting ready to fire me. And you know, what are you going to do? Well, they didn't. He went back and worked it out. But I mean, it happened to Brian Croft, guys. If it can happen to Brian Croft, it can happen to you. And yeah. So that's what we're talking about today. A lot of times, Dr. Rayner, when it happens, there's this immediate sense that I'm just a failure. I've done something terribly wrong. As we're going to talk about later in this podcast, many times it's just the church you walked into, and they're just working out their problems on you that they've had with other pastors. But we'll talk about that in a minute.
Well, Sam Rayner's told the story too. And again, like Brian, Sam won't mind me telling this because he's told it publicly. Sam was pushed out with a staff coup. And the staff coup aligned with a personnel committee. And Sam had to make a choice. Would he fight it or would he not? He would have been successful in a vote. He would not have been successful by staying on. So he decided to let the staff, and it was primarily an executive pastor, but there was another pastor or two involved with the personnel committee. They never told Sam why they were firing him, though. Mm-hmm. They never said why they wanted to be. They never gave a reason.
Yeah, and that's true. Most of the time in these very difficult situations, there's not a clear exit interview at all. Yes. And no one ever sits down and says, this is exactly what happened. It's always nebulous and sort of fuzzy. And that makes the guy feel even worse, that he doesn't even know exactly what happened.
Yep. So when you get fired or pushed out of church, the first point we want to say, and I think we've made this point pretty clear, you're among a large number of people if you get fired in ministry. I mean, yeah, and if it's not a badge that you want to wear proudly, but it is a badge that you can wear with the company.
And if you're watching this on YouTube, go ahead in the comment section and just let us know if this happened to you and that kind of thing. I would like to know that and like to read that. But because I do hear this every week from guys who are feeling like that's what's happening to them. And again, Dr. Rayner, they feel like we just said it. We're going to say it again. I want you, for everybody in the back row, you're not alone in this, all right? You're dealing with sometimes very dysfunctional churches and very dysfunctional people, and the adversary is completely at work in that church trying to disrupt it as much as possible. He's at work trying to disrupt you as much as possible, and you're not alone. If you've been asked to leave a church, if you feel like you're being pressured out of a church, now we're not talking about if you've had significant moral failure. That's another podcast for another day, but we're just talking about churches that are dysfunctional. And how many times, oh my goodness. And see, the reason I deal with this so much, it's guys who are doing revitalization. And so you got a church that's dying or that's declining. And quote, they always tell the pastor candidate, we want to change. We want to change and we want to grow.
We want to grow and we're
ready to follow your leadership. They always say that.
Yes.
And so this guy comes in thinking, telling his wife and his kids, this church is just ready to change. They want to follow my leadership. And oftentimes, Dr. Rayner, for a few months, it does go okay until they begin to understand what the cost of change really is. When they say change, what they mean many times is we want you to come in and be the worker bee and get all this done for us because we can't do it. Right. It doesn't mean we want you to change the things we value, we care about, and that we're used to seeing. And when you start changing those things, then you're going to get changed. And it's just a very common experience. And man, just hear us, please. Chuck, take it from me. I can absolutely back this up. You're not alone in this. And this is not the end of your ministry. Absolutely, it's not. In fact, you may grow tremendously from this. My friend Henry Blackaby used to always say, when you go through a tremendous fire, a tremendous struggle, something that just absolutely knocks your feet out from under you, if you remain obedient to God, he is preparing you for an even greater task ahead. And this is not a wasted experience. Can I say that? Even when you get fired or get pressed out, it's not a wasted experience. God can use it to edify you, to strengthen you, to bring wisdom to you. And you'll look back on your life, as many of these guys have, and said, that was a really important part of my ministry story. So I want you to know that today and be encouraged by that.
Yeah, I've told a few dismissed pastors that as well. And they said, I'd rather have less experience. I don't want to go through that. And some of them very close to me as well. It's when we say you're not alone, Mark and I have many close acquaintances, not just the broader pastoral ministry world, but many close acquaintances who have been let go. You're not alone. And even though your ministry is not perfect, pastor or staff person, the reality of it is most of you did not deserve to get fired. It just is the bottom line there. Okay, sometimes the problem, Mark, is with, we use the phrase preacher-eater churches. churches that go through pastors like a chewing gum addict goes through a Wrigley pack. It is one piece after another.
I know. Years ago, I worked for a Southern Baptist state convention. And, you know, in our Southern Baptist world, we can't place pastors. Churches choose their pastors and pastors choose where to go. So we have very little influence on that. But we used to say if we could put pastors in the places we need to put them, we had a group of churches that would chew up pastors and kill them. And we had a group of pastors that would chew up churches and kill them. And we figured if we could ever just put those two things together, they would take care of themselves. But, the churches that chewed up pastors always got the good ones. And the churches that killed the pastors that killed churches always got the, they never went the right way. But there are certain congregations that have it in their DNA that they just like to run off pastors. I mean, just like to, there's a power group in there. We could talk about this all day, why that's the case. But they like to call the pastor because that empowers them when they call him, right? They're the ones right. that get to select him, get to anoint him. He owes them something. They love that process.
Yes.
And then they just kind of wait for him to do something that they know is going to upset people. Then they can become powerful again and get rid of him. And then they can find another one. A lot of that has to do, Dr. Rayner, with the fact that, if you'll allow me, this leadership group, and it's always nebulous, they are really serving in the pastor role, but they're not appointed, they're not anointed, they're not an under-shepherd, they're not gifted, they're not called. But when a pastor comes and goes every 18 months, 24 months, 36 months, well, there's got to be some continuity of leadership in that church. And a lot of times this power group is that continuity of leadership, and they really enjoy that position. And when a pastor comes in and he begins to really become the leader, he threatens that continuity of leadership, and then they just get rid of him, and then they're back in power again. Then they can pick another person, and they're the people that, you get what I'm saying. And so you walk into that situation, and this group is really talented at making you believe they really want you there and they're going to follow your leadership. And it can be absolutely devastating, especially if this is your first church and you really, man, you really feel like this is where God calls you. You want to plant your life here. You're going to buy a house. You're going to buy a cemetery plot. You're going to raise your kids here. It's going to be the place, right? And then 2.5 years later, they're saying, this isn't working and you probably need to hit the road. And oftentimes they don't even give you a decent going-away gift, a severance package, no, at all. I hear guys that call me and say, they gave me 2 weeks' salary. I think, oh, my goodness. So it happens. And it's happen. Church. It's oftentimes, as Dr. Rayner says, it's the churches that are dysfunctional that are doing this. And they're absolutely cyclical in it. They keep doing it time after time after time. So when you're looking to go to a church, by all means, find out what they did the last pastor or two.
Let me tell you what I did with a guy in a coaching call during the pandemic, during the 2020 portion of the pandemic. We got to now specify the year during the 2020 portion of the pandemic. He called me up and he says, church is looking at me very seriously. I'm thinking about going. What do you recommend? I said, well, do this. Just do this exercise. Ask them to send you the names and the years of tenure of the most recent pastors. I said, you know, go five or six back. Well, they sent him a list of eight, and the total tenure was 12 years.
Eight in 12 years.
And I said, you know, that's a warning flag. Well, what do you mean? Well, they're going through pastors like Baptists go through business meetings. They just eat them alive. He said, well, I've talked to them about this, and they told me it'll be different this time. Right.
It's like a major league team that's had, you know, five coaches in the last 9 years. I mean, do you want to be the next coach? I mean, you know, it doesn't look real promising. There's that history of pulling the string real early and moving them on. And absolutely, you got to look at that. You really do. And we'll do another podcast on dysfunctional churches and why they do this. I'm really interested in that. And I think we've got some real insights on why that happens.
We will.
But man, I'll tell you what. Yeah. Church eater. What do you call it? Pastor eater churches. Is that what you call it?
Preacher eater churches.
Preacher eater churches.
Doesn't it have a flow to it?
I mean, that's not a book. I don't think that would be a book right there.
Not a book, but it has a flow to it. Preacher eater churches.
Preacher eater churches. All right. Good enough.
You mentioned, Mark, that this is also an opportunity for the pastor to learn something. And sometimes the pastor does have fault, and we'll be talking about that in part two of this series, when you fail in a church. But just a word here, if you have any fault, look at what you did, even if it's not the dominant thing that caused the domino to fall or for you to leave. Look at what you did and learn from it. Make the changes that you need to make. And there, that's what you said. This is always an opportunity.
It is. And I'll just give you an example. All right. Young man that I've mentored and worked with, good young man, great young man, doing a great job in ministry right now. All right. His first church right out of the gate was a little church in a little town that had a history of problems, but they were looking for a young pastor to turn him around, and they were going to follow him and do whatever he wanted. So there you go. So he goes, he's all excited. It comes around, they're about 4 or 5 months, Dr. Rayner, and it's the 4th of July week, right?
I love Independence Day.
Yeah. And, you know, this is a kid in his 20s, you know, and sort of the idea that if we don't sing it in heaven, we shouldn't sing it in church. Right. So we're not going to sing political, patriotic songs on 4th of July. Yeah, that was a bit of a problem to the congregation because they had done that their entire life. And he didn't really talk to them about that. He just said, we're not going to do that. And that eventually led to his termination.
Wow.
So what did he learn from that? Well, I think he learned tactical patience.
Yes.
I think he learned the next time you go, just because it's happening doesn't mean you necessarily agree with it and doesn't mean it's necessarily going to happen forever. But there are ways to approach it and ways not to approach it. And so I think he learned an important lesson from that and grew tremendous. It was very painful, but he grew a lot from it. And it could be any number of things like that where it happened to me when my very first church, I was 18, 19 years old at this time. I went there when I was 18, I was about 19. And we had this tapestry behind the pulpit. I'm not making this up. It was the Lord's Supper tapestry, but it looked like it was on black velvet, like you would get at a truck stop.
Oh, I can see it right now. I can see it on the side of the road being sold in the panhandle of Florida. And I can see it in churches.
So I'm 19 years old, you know, I know everything, right? So I look at that and I think, well, that just doesn't look right. Right. So I just take it down, you know, we're just going to take that thing down. Somebody very important had bought that and placed it there. And, I nearly got fired over that. And in fact, if I hadn't had an older member just come in and say, he's an idiot kid, he's learned his lesson, let's hang on with him, I probably would have gotten fired. But I learned a lot at 19 about doing stuff like that, that now has really helped me in replanting. You just have to have tactical patience. And so a lot of times you may get fired, but you will learn from it. But you do need to step back and go, okay, what was my role in this? There are some guys, Dr. Rayner, they're completely innocent. They're just whatever. Right. This power group realized you're getting more power than they are, and they're not going to put up with that.
Right.
And so they're going to find a reason to get rid of you. That does happen. But the other times you give them a reason. You move a flag, you take down a picture, you move a Sunday school class, you make some changes, you don't talk to the right people, and you don't have the ability in your leadership yet to do that. And you get burned by it. Next time you go someplace, you'll learn to build consensus around you and take things slower and use tactical patience and all the other things we talked about.
Every pastor that comes to a church has titular or what is often called formal authority. Authority by the title, authority by the position. So whatever your positional authority, titular authority, or formal authority, it is not until you have informal authority where they're really buying into you that you can make a lot of these unnecessary early changes.
And that's basically never hardly before year three, and many times about year five.
Year five, exactly. Yeah. This last point, understand that bad fit is not failure. It could be that you are not the person for that church and that church is not the person for you. God doesn't make mistakes, but humans, pastors, and churches do. And it may have been obvious that you were not going to be a fit, or it may not until you've been there a while. But that does not mean that you fail just simply because you're not a good fit for it.
I had one guy tell me, you know, I thought I could manage a sweet tea culture, but I can't. He was from the north, and he said, this is like a sweet tea culture. And I thought I could manage it, but I'm not a sweet tea culture guy. I'm not a Southern guy, and this is what they need. And I realize I've just made a mistake, and I am monocultural, he said, and I just need to go where my culture is at this point.
That's wild.
I've never forgotten that. You know, I'm just not a sweet tea culture guy. I mean, and there is a sweet tea culture. There's definitely that.
Mark, we were having our annual meeting with some of our coaching clients that are part of that upper tier group. And one of them, I'm going to give the name, his name, I'm going to give it, is Mike Rubino. We love Mike. he pastors in Long Island.
Yeah.
And they were coming, and we were having this particular time together in Nashville. Well, they're serving the drinks, and his wife, Heather, we love her too. She took a drink and she said, "What is this?" She had her first sweet tea. And Mike said he had to get her to stop drinking it because he thought she was getting drunk on it. Give me another round. She had never. And if many of the restaurants in Nashville have sweet, sweet tea, not the stuff you put sugar in and stir, but the stuff that is boiled in from the
vineyard. Right. What'd they say? If the spoon doesn't stand up by itself, it's not sweet enough in the tea. I mean, it's just like syrup. No, I get it. So sometimes it's just, look, you had the right intention. You really wanted to go. They really wanted you there. And you just feel like this is, and let's be honest. Can we just be honest?
No,
sometimes you just need a job. You want a place to preach, right? And this is the only place that's asked you to come, and you take it. Hey, you're not the worst person in the world for doing that. But when you realize, you know, I probably need not be here, understand that and just move on and let it go. Is that right?
That's right. Hey, thank you, audience, both those who are listening by audio on the podcast, those who are watching by YouTube. Give us a comment, a rating, a review, subscribe to us.
Yes.
On YouTube as well. Just get this flow, get this melodious voice of Mark Clifton and Kevin Ezell flowing to you on a regular basis. And we're going to continue this series. The series, once again, is Why Failure in Ministry is Not Final. And we've talked about the tough issue now, when you get fired or pushed out at a church. Now we're going to talk about another tough issue in the second part, when you fail at a church. But keep in mind, part three is about recovery, bouncing back. And so we're going to have a good ending to this. So thank you again for being with us, viewing on YouTube, listening on the podcast. Continue to listen, watch, revitalize, and replant. Again, be sure to subscribe on Church Answers YouTube channel or iTunes, Google, Podcast, Spotify, wherever you listen to the podcast. And come back where we're revitalizing and replanting to get churches healthy together. Mark, yes,
you have a comment. I got to say something here. If you're struggling with being fired, if your family is struggling with that, if your kids are struggling with that, don't go through that alone. Just email replant@nam.net. We'll put it in the show notes and we'll be delighted to hook you up. I don't care whether you're a Southern Baptist or not. We just want to help you walk through that, help give you some help. Don't go through this alone, especially with your kids and your wife. It's maybe the most traumatic experience you may have ever had to get fired from a church. And so we'll help you. So if you need help, just reach out to us at replant@nam.net. We've got some resources, some things we can plug in. I want you to know that we do care about you. You're important in God's kingdom and He's not through with you yet.
Gracious solver. Thank you, Mark. And thank you, listeners, again. Continue to be with us where we're seeking to get churches healthier together.